Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is my honor and pleasure to be here amongst you this wonderful evening as we have gathered in order to learn about our faith. Many people tonight, they're busy doing what? They're going in this cold from house to house, trick and treating, right? But alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with something that is beneficial. Instead of going, you know, wasting our time, yes, it could be interesting fun for our youth, but really it's a waste of time and a waste for your teeth as well if you eat too much candy. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us on this evening to gather, to discuss our faith, and see how we can solidify our identity. So I would truly want to thank you, all of you, who took from your time to attend this wonderful evening, to attend this wonderful discussion. We are the followers of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. And really every Muslim who loves the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, should follow the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. Now, when we examine our identity, we are known to be the Shia. Many of us are not aware of the origin of this word. What does the word Shia mean? And how did we end up with this name? Who called us the Shia? Did some random government during the time of the Imams or group or school of thought decide to call us Shia, and for 14 centuries we've been called the Shia? When we examine the history of this word, first of all, we refer to the Holy Quran. What is the meaning of the word Shia? In the Arabic language, the meaning of the word Shia means a follower, someone who follows something. We have a verse in the Holy Quran which says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ شِيَعَتِهِ لَإِبْرَاهِيمِ. God is speaking about Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, and he's saying that amongst the Shia of Prophet Nuh is who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's one of his followers because he followed the path of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. So the word Shia is mentioned in the Holy Quran, and the meaning of it is a follower. So we're followers, right? Who do we follow? What are we followers of? Ibn Asakir, this Sunni scholar, he says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the last verse of Surah Al-Bayyinah, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ, the last verses of Surah Al-Bayyinah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking of certain groups of people, and then he says, those who believe and do good, they are the best of creation. Ibn Asakir, he says, the Prophet, peace be upon him, pointed to Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, and he said, oh Ali, those people who are the best of creation are you and your followers, you and your Shia. The Prophet, peace be upon him, uses the word Shia in this hadith, which Ibn Asakir, the Sunni scholar, narrates. So the one who gave us the honor, brothers and sisters, of being called the Shia is the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. He gave us this name, this amazing name, and it means that we follow Al-Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, because he is the successor to the Holy Prophet. Now we are honored to have this title. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this wonderful title. Unfortunately, many of us throughout history have not done justice to this title. One day, a man comes to the 11th Imam of Ahlul Bayt, Al-Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. He tells him, oh Imam, I am one of your Shia. The Imam alayhi salam is disappointed. The Imam alayhi salam tells him, do you follow our teachings? Do you obey us something which we have prohibited? Do you abstain from it? Do you sin? He lowered his head. He said, yes, Imam, I honestly admit I don't follow everything that you say. Some things I follow, some things I don't follow. The Imam alayhi salam says, then how can you claim to be a Shia? A Shia means someone who practically follows. When you're not practically following us, how do you consider yourself to be a Shia? So the man lowered his head and he felt embarrassed. He said, okay, what do I say? The Imam alayhi salam told him, say, I love you, the Ahlul Bayt. I love you and I respect you, but if you want to truly be a Shia, you have to respect the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And this is truly a lesson for us. In another hadith, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, he gives us a beautiful description of who his Shia is. The Imam alayhi salam says, my Shia are those who pursue knowledge. They have patience and perseverance. When you look at them, you are reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are we like that? When people look at us and our actions, are they reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then the Imam alayhi salam says, when you look at their lips have withered because of how much they mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see them, they're weak, they're tired. When you look at their faces, they're yellow. Why? Because they are constantly working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They never take time, you know, to rest too much and say, we need to achieve comfort in this life. The Imam says, these are my true Shia. Then the Imam alayhi salam says, fawa shawqahu ilayhim. How much I miss such people. How much I miss my Shia, those who have such qualities. So when we think of our identity as being Shia of the Ahlul Bayt, we need to realize that this is an amazing status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Let us treat this status with full respect. Now, the other point that I'd like to share with you before we begin the answer and discussion forum, we as the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we often think of ourselves, what is it that differentiates us from other Muslims? We are all Muslims, absolutely. We all follow the Holy Quran. We follow the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. We say the Shahadatain. What is it that distinguishes us from other Muslims? This is a valid question that many people ask. One very important aspect that distinguishes the Shia from other schools of thought is that we Shia believe that the authority after the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, is who? Is the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Holy Prophet. Because the Prophet, he himself, he tells us, as the Prophet, peace be upon him, was on his deathbed, and Bukhari narrates this incident, and it's called the Black Thursday. The Prophet says, bring me a pen and paper so I can dictate to you a formula that if you practice this formula, you shall never go astray. What does the Prophet tell us? I leave behind me two weighty things. The Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what? My Sahaba? No. Khilafah? No. What does the Prophet say? Ahl Bayti, Itrati. I leave after me the Book of Allah and my family. We, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, what distinguishes us is that we take our religion from the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. And we're not being conservative when we say that, or we're trying to be sectarian. Because I remember there was this one brother who came up to me, and he says, look, why bring this issue and create division? We all follow the Prophet. Why is it that we have the Shia way of praying, the Sunni way of praying? Why? Why do you create division? Let's pray one unified prayer. You know, we should have one way of praying. And why is this disunity that we have? You know, and he was joking about it. He says, you know, we should all be Sushis, Sunnis and Shias. You've heard this phrase, right? I told him, you know, that's a very nice title. And hopefully, you know, we wish we could all be Sushis in the sense that we could unite on the right path. But let me ask you the question. Do we have a sushi salah? Tell me. I want to pray right now in front of you the sushi way, okay? How do I do it? You tell me. Show it to me. Show me one salah that will unite everyone. How am I going to pray a sushi salah? At the end of the day, I have to ask myself, from who do I get my religion? I want to pray like the Prophet, peace be upon him, did. Absolutely. I want unity. I want to respect other people. But at the same time, I want to pray like the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, used to pray. I trust my Imam, Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq, and he tells me the Prophet used to pray this way. In fact, when you look at the books and you analyze them, even Sunni books, we realize how the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to pray. The Prophet, peace be upon him, according to Sahih al-Bukhari, he says, جُعْلِيَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا. He says, the ground, the earth, has been made a place of sujood for me. So I want to pray like the Prophet prayed. Did the Prophet pray on carpet? No, he didn't. Did he pray on a piece of cloth? No, he used to pray on the ground. And when we carry this muhr, this turba, in essence, we're not worshiping this. We're simply praying on the ground. Because do you see any dust or sand in this hall? No, obviously. If you will not place that turba, you're going to do sujood on the ground. So I pray like the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, used to pray. And in everything that I do, I follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I don't want to create disunity or I want to denounce other sects. Not at all. I wish we could create unity. But at the same time, I want to get my religion from a trusted source. When you look at the Quran, yes, it does praise the companions. But brothers and sisters, not all the companions were good. The Quran has an entire chapter called Surat Al-Munafiqun, the chapter of the hypocrites, okay? Who were those hypocrites? What happened to them? You know, when you look at history, and when you look at some schools of thought and they examine this history, it's as if the Munafiqeen just disappeared when the Prophet died. I don't know what happened to them. Were they transported to Mars, to the moon? Did the earth swallow them? I don't know. The Quran in Surat Bara'a, Surat At-Tawbah, in one verse it says, around you, min al-A'rab, from these people who lived in Medina around the Prophet, maradu ala nifaq. You had certain companions who insisted on their hypocrisy. They grew up on hypocrisy. This is the Quran. This is the Quran. You want me to take my religion, which is the dearest thing in my life, from people who were hypocrites? Yes, there were good companions. We take the religion from them. But there are hypocritical companions. I cannot take my religion from them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me an intellect. Doesn't the Quran say that the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, is a messenger of God just like other messengers? When he dies, أَفَإِن مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ, or he's killed, إِن قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ, the Prophet is saying, oh, you companions, when you heard that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, صَلُّوا عَلَىٰ مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلِي مُحَمَّدْ, when you heard that he died, there was a rumor in the battle of Uhud that the Prophet died, they all turned away and left, except for five. And one of them was the Imam alayhi salam, one of them was that lady. You've heard the story. How am I going to take my religion, brothers and sisters, from people who fled and left Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? That doesn't make sense. So I, as a follower of Ahlul Bayt, I take my religion from a trusted source, from a source in which the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, directed me to. Otherwise, you know, they have this hadith that tells you all of my companions are stars. Any star you take, you shall be guided. Okay. You know, when you go to Hujr ibn Udi, this companion of the Prophet and the Imam alayhi salam, you know, there was this person from another school of thought. He was asked, tell us, who does this grave belong to? He says, this is the grave of Sayyidina Hujr ibn Udi. This is the grave of our master, Sayyidina Hujr ibn Udi, very good companion. They told him, why is he buried here? Who killed him? He said, Sayyidina Muawiyah killed him. That's why he's buried here. And they told him, why did Muawiyah kill him? He said, because he refused to denounce Sayyidina Ali. Subhanallah. Muawiyah killed Sayyidina Hujr because he refused to denounce Sayyidina Ali, and they're all Sayyids and they're all going to paradise. Do you accept this? Does your intellect really accept this? I, as a follower of Ahlul Bayt, I take my religion from a trusted source, from the family of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. So when we think of our identity as followers of Ahlul Bayt, as Shia, we respect all schools of thought. Yes, we pursue unity, but we will not compromise. I will never compromise the Ahlul Bayt. Because the Quran and Ahlul Bayt go hand in hand together. If you eliminate one of them, you have gone astray. So with these words, inshallah, would open the floor to questions and answers. We'd like to hear from you tonight. Let's have a protective session, inshallah. مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل.
أحسنت سيد. So with that, I just want to remind everyone the two forms in which we will be taking the questions in today. The first form is by writing down the question and passing it to our volunteers roaming on both the guys' and the girls' side. The other way is to use social media, and we encourage all youth to make use of social media, especially the ones who are watching online. This is your way to participate. Post your questions at Jaffrey Youth through Twitter, and inshallah, we will pass that over to Sayyid to be answered. So let's start off with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
So the first question of the night, symbolism plays a huge role in Shia Islam in comparison to other sects. We put more emphasis on specific events and special places, especially in reference to Muharram and holy shrines. What is the best way to explain to other Muslims that we aren't in fact taking it too far in revering specific events and locations rather than taking a more holistic view of Islam?
Excellent question. We, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, especially during days like Muharram, events like Muharram, we place a huge emphasis on these symbols. Wearing black for Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, or visiting the shrine of an Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. These are all symbols. Even these gatherings which we hold are symbols. How can we explain this to other Muslims and why we attach so much importance to these symbols? Whenever you want to start a discussion with your fellow Muslim about why we attach so much emphasis on symbols, you can always start with the Holy Kaaba. Have you asked yourself, what is the Kaaba? What's the Kaaba really, which is so important? Every Muslim must face the Kaaba at least 5 times a day. Otherwise, your prayer will not be accepted, right? What is this Kaaba? Kaaba is a cubic-shaped building, right? It's a building. What is it made of? It's made of rocks, stones. Nothing special from that way, right? It's just a building that has been destroyed throughout history and created and destroyed since Prophet Adam, since Prophet, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam. So many times has the Kaaba been demolished either by people or floods or whatever it is and rebuilt. So when you examine the rock and structure of it, it's nothing special. It's just a building. But what is the Kaaba? Ask a Muslim, why do you face the Kaaba? You know, according to the Wahhabi ideology, this should be shirk, right? When they tell you that when you pray on the turba, this is shirk, tell them what? If you face the Kaaba, that's not shirk, what's the difference? They're both stone. You face the stone or you put your head on the stone? Does that really make a difference? One of them is shirk and one of them is not shirk. See, they have misunderstood the basis of Islam. Islam is a religion which is based on symbols. The Kaaba is a symbol which represents the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. God is not physical. We can't see him. We can't touch him. We can't hear him, right? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that the human being interacts, the human mind interacts with symbols very well. I mean, when you go outside, you see signs everywhere, right? What are signs? They're symbols. That's how we communicate. Language in itself is symbol. Every word is a symbol that means something. Allah knows this very well. Therefore, he's given us a house called the Kaaba, and this represents the house of God. When you face the Kaaba, you're not really facing this building. You're facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's symbolic. So every Muslim must place an emphasis on the Kaaba, right? Because the Kaaba is our direction. But the Kaaba is only a means which takes you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same with every act, salah. We all pray 5 times a day, hopefully, inshallah. What is salah? Have you asked yourself? Bowing, prostrating. You know, if someone looks at you and they have no clue what you're doing, they'd be surprised. You know, what is this person? Is he playing some sort of exercise up and down? It doesn't make sense. But every act of salah is a symbol. Your takbir is a symbol. The ruku' is a symbol. The sujood is a symbol. So the religion of Islam revolves around symbols. And it places a huge emphasis on symbols. We, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we consider Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam to be one of the greatest symbols of God. Because he sacrificed his life for what? For the religion of Islam. And that's why the Sunni scholar, Al-Ajmiri, he says, Al-Islam, Muhammadiyul Wujud, Husayniyul Baqa. Islam owes its inception, you know, its beginning to the Holy Prophet. He's the one who established Islam. But at the same time, the religion of Islam owes its survival to who? to Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. So the Imam revived the religion for me, brothers and sisters. He's a symbol of God. Therefore, I glorify the symbol of God. When I wear black to show my sadness for an Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, this is a symbol that means I reject injustice. I uphold justice. And this is amazing. And that's why we place so much emphasis on these symbols. These symbols take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If anyone disputes with you, just talk to them about the Kaaba. Talk to them about stoning the devil. That's another symbol. When we examine these Islamic rituals, we see that they're based on symbols.
So the next question. Marjaiyyat is a huge point of contention between Shiism and other sects. Why do we place such an importance on Marjaiyyat while no other sects see it as a necessary part of Islam?
Many Muslims, they think that it is only the Shia who have the system of Marjaiyyat. Now, what does Marjaiyyat mean? Let's clarify linguistically what is the meaning of the word Marja. The word Marja in Arabic means a reference. So that's why even in Arabic, we call a book marja. Because it's a reference, you refer to it to gain knowledge, to seek an understanding. Marja is a person who acts as a reference. You go to a marja because this person acts as a reference who teaches you about the religion of Islam. Now when you examine the meaning of a marja and what a marja does, the role of a marja, it becomes very clear to you that every Muslim throughout history has a marja. But simply, we're not aware of that. Because what do you do with a marja? You follow that marja, right? You emulate them. They form opinions and ideas, and you simply follow them. I ask you, other than the school of Ahlul Bayt, we have four schools of thought, right? What are these schools of thought? Have we ever examined what does it mean for a person to be Hanbali? A person to be Maliki, Shafi'i? What does it mean? Every Muslim who considers himself to be a Hanbali, who follows the Hanbali school of thought, is following who? Ahmad ibn Hanbal. That's his marja. He's following his ideas, right? Every person who considers himself Shafi'i, he's following a Shafi'i. People who consider themselves Maliki, they're following Malik. Malik is their marja. The only difference between the Shia school of thought and the Sunni schools of thought is that in Sunni schools of thought, you only have four main maraja, and that's the Shafi'i, Malik, Abu Hanifa, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. You have four grand maraja that for centuries people have been following. We, the Shia, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we believe that every time requires a marja because circumstances change, new things come up, science teaches us new aspects of life, there are new challenges. We need a living marja who acts as a reference to teach us about our faith. I can't depend on some marja who lived 1,000 years ago to give me the challenges of living in Toronto in 2014. That doesn't work. I need a living marja who is aware of my circumstances, who is aware of the new challenges, and who can deliver to me the religion of Islam. So we, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we believe in the system of marja'iyyah. Others also believe in the system of marja'iyyah. They don't call it that, but that's what it is. Every school of thought in the Sunni faith is actually following a specific marja, a specific reference. So we, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we follow the Quran. We follow the Sunnah of the Prophet, the hadith of the Imam. But brothers and sisters, the hadith that were mentioned by the Prophet and the Imam, they go back to 14 centuries ago. Did you hear what the Prophet said? No. None of us were present there. How do I know that this hadith is correct? How do I know what the teachings of the Prophet are? I need an expert who spent 30, 40, 50 years of his lifetime going through every single hadith, studying the Holy Quran, the history of Islam, logic, philosophy, to tell me what's right and what's wrong in terms of practicing my faith. Yes, when it comes to the pillars of faith, I don't follow anyone. When it comes to believing in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I don't follow any marja. You follow your intellect. Your intellect tells you God exists. God is just. He sent prophets. Prophets should have imams to protect their religion. They're infallible. They have knowledge. There's a day of judgment. In these areas, I don't follow. But when it comes to praying, how I pray, how I fast, how I do the Hajj. I need my marja to tell me how to do these things, because I didn't see the Prophet how he prayed. I didn't see Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam how he prayed. I need a reliable, trustworthy source to tell me, based on his research and expertise, how the Imam alayhi salam, for example, used to pray. And this is why we place a huge emphasis on the system of marja'iyya in the Shia school of thought. Because we have to analyze our history and see how the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to practice faith. So this is why we place a huge emphasis on it. Because we want to practice our religion from a trusted source.
Next question. As Shias, what system of government do we support? If we support democracy, what is the difference between us and those who elected Abu Bakr at Saqifah? If it's an aristocracy, how do we defend it and explain our view on divine appointment and how it's different than the views of divine appointment used by corrupt monarchs of the past?
When it comes to the system of ruling a government, we have two scenarios. Scenario number one is the scenario in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen someone for us. When God chooses someone for me, I have no right to come up with a democratic system and say, let's choose our leader. That doesn't work. When God chooses for you, you accept the selection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, in the Holy Quran, how do we validate this point? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard. O David, we have made you as a khalifa. Now let's say a group of people during the time of Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, they say, you know what, let's call for free elections. We don't want Dawood as the khalifa. Let's choose another khalifa. Doesn't this contradict the Holy Quran? When God has chosen someone for you, you have to stick to that person. Because Allah knows whom He chooses. Allah knows when I've chosen Imam Ali alayhi salam to lead this ummah, Imam Ali is infallible. He can judge between the people the best way possible. He's the most knowledgeable, and so on and so forth. God knows these things. God knows the intentions of the Imam, my intentions, your intentions. We don't know the intentions of other people. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen someone for us, we cannot say, no, let's make our own system. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fine, you want to do your own system? Let's see. 11, 12, 13 centuries, look, the Muslim ummah is in a mess. Bloodshed, problems, look at the history. Who came after the Holy Prophet, Bani Umayyah, Bani Al-Abbas? When was justice ever established in our history? It's because we did not follow those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had appointed, and this is a problem. And by the way, when you hear that those first three caliphs were elected by the people, brothers and sisters, that's a myth. They were not elected by the people. The only khalifa who was democratically elected, by the way, was Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. As for the first khalifa, you've all heard about the incident of Saqifa when they threatened certain individuals that you have to give bay'ah and allegiance, and they threatened. Sa'd ibn Ubadah, they almost trampled and killed him because he refused to pay allegiance. Malik ibn Nuwayra, this man, he refused to pay allegiance. They killed him, they raped his wife, they destroyed his village under the leadership of Khalid ibn al-Walid. We have to read this history, brothers and sisters. So how is this, you know, a democracy? How is this a democracy? They selected the first Khalifa. He wasn't elected by all of the Muslims. Number one. Number two, the second Khalifa. Did the people elect him? No. Who selected him? The first Khalifa. He said in his will, as he was dying, I want Umar to be my Khalifa. And subhanAllah, you know, it's amazing how Muslims, when they examine this history, they don't use this intellect. The Prophet can die without selecting a Khalifa, but Abu Bakr, he has to select a Khalifa. You know, if you follow the Sunnah of the Prophet, die like the Prophet died, don't select anyone, right? But we see that he actually selected someone after him. And then when Uthman came to power, it's the same scenario. Umar created, you know, a council of six people, and he set it up in a way in which Uthman would be the Khalifa. The only man whom people came and they begged him to be their Khalifa and leader was Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. So this is the first scenario. When God chooses someone for us, There is no room for us coming up with our own ideas, elections, and democracy. No, have that person rule, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen that person. And just like God chooses his prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also chooses the successors of the prophets. This is scenario number one. Then we have scenario number two. In the absence of a leader which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen, such as in our modern times. Yes, our leader is Imam al-Mahdi, absolutely. But the Imam alayhi salam is not visibly ruling us. The Imam alayhi salam is in absence. The Imam alayhi salam is in a state of occultation. In this scenario, what do we do? The majority of our ulama, they say in such a scenario, the religion of Islam encourages what is called shura, which is another word for democracy, in which people, they consult. It's called the idea of consultation. And consultation is democracy because a group of people, they get together, they consult what's good for their society, and then they choose someone. However, our scholars state that democracy in itself, by itself, cannot protect the rights of the people and the religion of the people. Because you could have evil people taking advantage of the people, right? They could brainwash them, they could have power, they could have a lot of money, and they could use that to create their own democracy. So our scholars have said that in scenario number two, in the absence of an imam, we do allow for a democracy, but the scholars, they have to oversee it. The scholars who know what's best for our societies, what's best for our religion, they have to act as overseers. So when they see that something is not being applied properly, it goes against the teachings of the Quran, they should have a say to correct the corruption that goes on in a society. So most of our scholars, they accept democracy, but they say that it has to be done in conjunction with the scholars. They have to oversee this democratic system to make sure that it's going in the correct way. So these are pretty much the two scenarios that we have.
The next question. During these times when the number of oppressed people around the world continues to rise, what can we practically do in the West for our brothers being oppressed worldwide, especially with protest and letters seen to be having little effort?
We have many narrations that tell us as time progresses and as we get closer to the reappearance of our Imam, may Allah hasten his reappearance, the test will become more and more difficult. And oppression and injustice will spread to all corners of the globe. So we automatically know then that oppression will be on the rise if we don't do something. The hadith are telling us that if you don't actively do something, if you let history take its course, the oppression and injustice will begin to increase in society. Now the question is, what can I do? In light of all this injustice, what can I do? You know, we have the honor of participating in the revolution of our Imam alayhi salam. Because when you examine, what is the goal of the Imam? What is the objective of an Imam al-Mahdi? What does he want? The Imam alayhi salam, his major objective is to establish what? Justice and equity in society. That's what the Prophet tells us. He will fill the earth with justice and equity, just as it had been filled with injustice and oppression. So if you, brothers and sisters, want to help the Imam of your time in achieving his mission, start working for justice now, because this is the goal of the Imam alayhi salam. And we have many narrations that tell us when the Imam reappears, he will have people who support him. Yes, we have the 313 very close companions, but we also have other supporters. And by the way, 50 of those 313 are women. They also will participate in the mission of the Imam alayhi salam. And then the next group of people, you will have 10,000 believers who will be readily waiting to support the Imam alayhi salam. But in the time of the absence, there is also a method for me to work for that goal. Number one, when you think of justice and how to eliminate oppression, you always have to start with square one. What is square one? Can someone tell me? If you want to rid the world from injustice and oppression, where do you have to start? Can you say that louder? You have to start with yourself, with your nafs. If I can't purify my nafs from injustice, from oppression, you think I can purify my society from injustice and oppression? That's why the greater jihad is what? The jihad of the nafs. Once you're able to conquer yourself and establish justice at the individual level, at the family level, inside your house, then you can bring justice to your society. So when you think about yourself, brothers and sisters, and what can I do, you don't have to think of yourself carrying guns and rifles and leading revolutions. No. This is not what the Imam wants from us, brothers and sisters. Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam in one hadith says, if you want to be amongst the supporters of Al-Imam al-Mahdi, you have to do two things. One is piety, and the second thing, you have to uphold the best akhlaq. These are the two things that you can do to support the mission of the Imam. Because once you purify yourself from injustice and oppression, then you can serve your society. This is number one. Number two comes at the practical level. With all the bloodshed that we see going on around the world, what can I do? First of all, I truly believe that we, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, in order for us to defend our rights and the rights of those who are mercilessly and brutally being killed every day, in order to protect their rights, we have to create a lobby. We have to pressure our society, government officials. You know, it's very unfortunate that we really don't care practically what's going on around the world. I hear one day in the morning that, you know, 500 people have been killed in Iraq and Karbala. I don't do anything. Many of us honestly don't even do dua for them. We just hear the news, it comes out straight the other ear, and that's it. As true followers of the Ahlul Bayt, we have to be active, because the Prophet says, if you wake up in the morning and you find yourself indifferent, apathetic, I don't care about what's going on in the Muslim world, the Prophet says, you're not a real Muslim. For me to be a real Muslim, I have to be concerned. One thing that you do, pick up the phone, call the local office of your government officials and tell them that you care. This is what others do in society. This is how the Jewish community is so successful in the West, because they have a powerful lobby. Whenever anything goes on, they're very vocal. You know, there was this writer who I think writes either for the Detroit News or the Detroit Free Press. Once he told my father, he says, you Muslims, you the Muslim community, you're very interesting. Because you, when we in the newspaper, if we write an article that praises Islam, that defends the Muslims, nobody cares. We don't get any phone calls, people thanking us, encouraging us. We don't get any emails from any Muslims. Maybe we get one or two or three, but generally speaking, we don't. And when we write an article against Islam and Muslims, we criticize something against Muslim communities, no one seems to care, no one calls to criticize, to object. And this is truly a tragedy that we are facing. And then this writer, he says, but with the Jewish community, when we write an article praising Israel, praising the Jewish community, the next morning we are flooded with phone calls, emails, contacts, thanking us, encouraging us, asking us for more. And oh boy, if we write an article criticizing Israel, it's the day of judgment. We are literally flooded with thousands of emails, letters, phone calls, people objecting to us from the Jewish community. They show concern. I need to, as a follower of Ahlul Bayt, brothers and sisters, I need to show concern. Demonstrate that in society. Contact various human rights groups. Tell them you care. Create your own lobby. Why is it that we, the Shia, don't have a lobby that supports us, that protects us, that defends our rights, that exposes our enemies? When you look at those others, people in society, when you see the most extremist people in the world, you know, those people who are supporting ISIS and doing the bombs and they consider the Shias to be heretics, these people, they have a strong lobby. They have a strong lobby, you know, in London, in Washington, in Ottawa, and other areas. And that's how they can hide their crimes. We, as the followers of Ahlul Bayt, in order for us to repel injustice, we have to create a lobby for ourselves in order to defend our rights. That's the only way that we can help the cause of Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Ta'ala, Faraja. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The next question hint back a little bit to the question you just answered. It's in a bit of more of a different context. Right now, if you search Shia Muslim on Google, all you see is pictures of people covered in blood in reference to self-flagellation. In the same context, often we're told not to talk to the media in fear of misinterpretation. How do we fight this stereotype and thoughts people seem to have of us, and how do we go about changing it?
To answer this question, let me ask you a question here. Alhamdulillah, we have many of the youth tonight. A lot of you have gone to college, you have a career, or you're pursuing to establish a career. Let me ask you a question, and I want to show, you know, I want you to show me my hands. How many of you are studying journalism, or you're looking into going into the media? Can I see a show of hands? Don't be shy, just say. We have one hand here, two, three, four. Our sisters, none of you in the journalism, you know, going into the media? Five? Okay, alhamdulillah. We have five from our youth tonight who are going into journalism. See, this is a problem. No, you five are not the problem. It's the low number that we have that it is the problem. This is a problem. When we have such a low number of our youth going into the media world, going into journalism, who's going to represent us? Who's going to voice our concerns? If I don't represent myself, others will misrepresent me. That's the problem that we have. The reason why when you go to Google and you, for example, click Shia or even Islam, even right now when you go on Google and click Islam, you know, the first 10, 20 results that you get, a lot of it is anti-Islam. People who are writing against Muslims, these people are terrorists, Islam is an extreme religion, a violent religion. It's our problem because we have not done our job in representing ourselves. If we flood the internet with articles, with books, you know, with journals, with newspaper articles representing ourselves, telling the world what Shia Islam is, telling the world what the religion of Islam is, then we will not really see this problem. Yes, maybe you still get some of those images or some of those articles, but that will be the minority. So the problem is we're not representing ourselves properly. Now, when it comes to these images, obviously we have no control over the internet, nor do we have control over what goes on around the world. You know, you have followers of Ahlul Bayt who are very passionate about Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, and in many parts of the world you will see them self-flagellating themselves. This is not something which we can control. But one thing that we can do when we are asked, you know, why is it that the Shias do this? Why is it that you, a group of people, you self-flagellate? You know, you beat your chest or you beat your backs or head with the sword. Why do you do that? We, first of all, need to educate ourselves. First of all, we shouldn't denounce, because I know some people, they will come out and start denouncing and they say, these people are not followers of Ahlul Bayt, they don't represent Imam al-Hussein. That's wrong. We cannot discredit people who are trying to show their love for the Imam alayhi salam. So we should never take that path and go in the media and say, okay, these people don't represent us. These people don't represent Ahlul Bayt. These are followers of Ahlul Bayt. Yes, I may disagree with them in how they're showing their love to Imam al-Hussein, alayhi salam, but at the end of the day, they could be sincere followers who are showing their emotion to Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, because the tragedy of Imam al-Hussein is a tragedy that humanity has not witnessed the like of. And these people would like to show that emotional support for the message of the Imam. So we cannot discredit them or attack them. At the same time, we also have to explain why certain group of people do that. We need to go to the media. First of all, explain the message of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. What does the Imam represent? And then tell them. There are groups of people throughout the world. These people are peaceful people. They're not harming anyone. They're not killing anyone. These people are not violent. These people, they love Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam so much, to such an extent that they're willing to show their emotions in such a way. And we as Muslims, we respect all cultures. Each culture has its own unique way in showing its emotions, in interacting with the message of Islam. And we give this freedom in the religion of Islam for anyone to show their love. And tell them, don't you see Christians? you know, who love Prophet Isa alayhi salam so much, and they'll do similar things. They'll self-flagellate. Would you consider these people as evil people who are against Jesus? No. You may disagree with them in the way that they're showing their love for Prophet Isa alayhi salam, but at the end of the day, you respect these people. They're trying to show their love for their, you know, symbol, their religious symbol, which is Prophet Isa alayhi salam. So I think by educating ourselves and by flooding the internet and the media with articles that correctly depict us and represent us, this will not really be a major issue. We can minimize this problem and we can give the proper image of the religion of Islam.
We do have a follow-up question on the question in regards to leadership and governance. If we assume that scholars are necessary to oversee a democracy in order to guard against corruption, what sort of safeguards are there to protect against mismanagement by the scholars, who themselves are fallible? Moreover, what sort of selection process is there to select the scholars with oversight power over the government? And there's also another follow-up. I'm not sure if you want to separate it in parts. Finally, how does this mesh with Sayyid Sistani's view, who is by far the most followed Marja in the Shia world, which is to favor guardianship of a jurist only when that jurist enjoys majority support among constituents?
So when it comes to the scholars overseeing an Islamic, a democratically elected government, some of our scholars have put forth the idea, as you mentioned, you know, our scholars are not infallible. They could make mistakes. Yes, they are respectful individuals, and they're very learned, and they've achieved the highest status in the religion of Islam. But at the end of the day, they're human beings, and we only believe the prophets and the imams are infallible. Anyone else can make a mistake. That's why some of our scholars believe that the maraja, the scholars who should oversee a democracy, there should be a council of them, and they call this shura al-fuqaha. So it's not only one scholar who's overseeing, but they say to minimize making mistakes, reducing the possibility of making mistakes, we should have a group of scholars. So for example, if in a country we have 10 maraja, all these maraja should theoretically get together on one council, and they should be the ones who oversee this, you know, government, this democracy. Once you have a group of, you know, 5, 6, 7, 10 maraja, you know, obviously this will significantly reduce the chances of them making mistakes. So they will oversee this government in the best and most appropriate way. So this is one view that some of our scholars have put forth. And this is a very valid view. It makes complete sense that the maraja, they work together, they cooperate with each other in order to oversee and watch over a democracy. Now, when it comes to the authority of the maraja, obviously you've heard of a term called wilayat al-faqih, which is the authority of a faqih. Now, our scholars throughout history all agree on the basics of wilayat al-faqih. No marja will tell you that I don't believe in wilayat al-faqih. That's impossible. Because we believe that the imams of Ahlul Bayt, they gave authority to the jurists. Because in the absence of the imam, the one who has authority are these scholars. And the imam alayhi salam in one hadith says that they are my hujjah on you, O people. They are my authority over you, and I am the authority over them. So the imam alayhi salam is the one who validated this system. So no scholar will argue with you that we don't believe in walayat al-faqih. Every scholar accepts walayat al-faqih, that the jurist has some sort of authority. Now, the only difference that we see amongst the scholars today is to the extent which a faqih, a scholar, has that authority. So, for example, generally speaking, you have the school of Najaf. They believe that a scholar does have that authority, but it's quite limited. You know, they don't believe that a scholar has the complete authority that the Imam alayhi salam has in ruling a government. They feel that a marja should oversee, should contribute, but does not have the actual authority that, for example, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif has. This is the school of Najaf, generally speaking. But then you also have another school, and this is mainly, you find this mainly in Iran. They say, no, based on our understanding of the religion of Islam and the science of hadith, we believe that the jurist should have absolute authority. So they both agree on the idea of a jurist having an authority, but they simply disagree to the extent which a scholar or a jurist has that authority.
Taking the Q&A just on a different turn, with it being Halloween, we should have expected a question like this one. Is it haram for kids to celebrate Halloween with friends? Of course not in Muharram, but even though not believing in it, are they allowed to participate in it?
You know, the religion of Islam is a very flexible religion. And Islam respects all cultures as long as they don't contradict the teachings of the Holy Quran. Now, whenever you're examining an event, such as Halloween, for example, such as Thanksgiving, ask yourself, number one, what is the significance of this event? What is the origin of it? So Thanksgiving, we all know, right? Thanksgiving, we get together, and we supposedly thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's beautiful. The Quran tells you to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'm asking you, celebrating an event like Thanksgiving, does that contradict the Holy Quran? Or actually, that's compatible with the Holy Quran. What do you say? Let me hear some answers from you. That's compatible because the Quran says, thank God. And Thanksgiving, yes, you know, maybe some people lose focus of what Thanksgiving really means. But originally, it was meant for people to thank their Creator, to thank God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So such events, they're compatible with the Holy Quran, as long as nothing haram is practiced in them, of course. Now, let me ask you about Halloween. Can someone who is educated and knows about Halloween, what is the origin of Halloween? What does it mean? I know it's fun, you know, you have that element of fear in it. It's kind of scary and interesting at the same time. You have the trick-or-treating. But what is the significance? Can someone who's well-informed tell us briefly? From the sister's side, from the brother's side? Come on, you live in this society. You should know what Halloween is. Yes. It's a pagan celebration in pre-Christian Europe, right? Okay. Does anyone agree with this, or you have a different understanding of what Halloween is? Yes, brother. So does it have to be, does it have to do with some sort of pagan history and events or no? All Saints Day, okay. Yes, brother, you have something to say? So it's the day in which the barrier between the dead and the living people is reduced. Okay. Now let me ask you. See, always respected brothers and sisters, when you deal with such cases, see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you conscience, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the human being, every human being, a sense of judgment where you can judge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you that. You have to just uncover it from your heart, from your mind. Based on what you've heard about the origin of Halloween, let me see a show of hands. How many of you think that, you know, an event like Halloween contradicts the Holy Quran? Let me see a show of hands. Okay, a few here, a few. We've got more on the brother's side. You're stricter tonight than the sisters. How many of you believe it's compatible with the Holy Quran and the teachings of Islam? Less hands, interesting. How many of you are confused? You really don't know. Okay, we got the majority of hands. So see, it's not a clear case. It's not a clear position. You know, does this, if I participate in the event of Halloween, does this actually support those pagan origins? Because if it does, then this is contradictory to the Holy Quran. Anything that I do that supports paganism is haram in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if this is considered an act of supporting that pagan history, then you pass the judgment. It becomes haram. But if you don't believe that this has anything to do with that pagan history, maybe the origin of it was like that, but these days no one even pays attention to this history. It's just, you know, a cultural aspect of our life where our kids get excited, they wear fancy weird stuff, costumes, and they distribute candy. It's just limited to that without any support to that pagan history. Then this does not contradict the Holy Quran. So we have to examine, we have to do the pros and cons, we have to balance and see if our society considers participating in an event like Halloween as supporting that pagan history, it becomes haram. If it is not considered as supporting that pagan history, then there's nothing wrong with it. So I leave the judgment to you, brothers and sisters. You, between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you believe that this could support that pagan history, then stay away from it. Alhamdulillah, we've got so many events throughout the history, throughout the year, that we can celebrate. You know, we can share candy with each other. We can celebrate and have a good time. But if you honestly, in your heart, you don't believe that has anything to do with the pagan history, it's just some fun time to spend with our children, for them to participate in the social act, then that's fine between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'm not a marja who will give you a fatwa on this issue. I won't tell you this is halal or haram. I've given you the way in which you can decide for yourself whether this is haram or not, whether this contradicts the Holy Quran or does not contradict the Holy Quran.
So the last question of the night, we will go in relation to your lecture that you had spoken about tonight. How can we explain feminism to non-Muslims from a Muslim's perspective, including the points you covered tonight, especially with hijab, as not everyone wears hijab and have different views on modesty?
Very valid question. I remember once, 2010, I think, when I was going to college, at the University of Michigan, we had, you know, I was taking this sociological class, and the discussion about women came up, you know, how are women viewed from a sociological perspective? And then our professor, he asked us, you know, what is the view of your religions? So the Christians, they gave their views. There were others who gave their views. And then I was asked, as I was the Muslim in the class, I was asked, what does the religion of Islam say about the role of women? And is there room for feminism in the religion of Islam? So I told my professor, I want to share with you a story. Some of you have probably heard this story, but the important aspect is the response that I got from this professor. You know, one day a man comes to the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and he tells him, Ya Rasulullah, before Islam, during the time of Jahiliyyah, I buried 6 daughters alive with my own hands. I killed them. I buried them alive. But one of them, I didn't feel bad about 5 of them. One of them I felt really bad. The Prophet was very disturbed when he heard this. He says, why? You know, you should feel bad about all of them. Why is it that you felt bad about 5 of them and not the 6th one? So he explained to the Holy Prophet. He says, I killed 5 of my daughters alive. I buried them. My wife became pregnant. I was out on a business trip. Now, when I came back, I asked my wife, you know, you gave birth to our child. What happened? Where is it a boy? Is it a girl? She told me that the child died and we buried it. You know, back then it would be very common for a child to die as a mother was going through labor. So the man got upset that he lost a child. He says, many years later, 5-6 years later, I would see this beautiful young girl who would come to our house. And my wife, she would play with that girl. I asked my wife, who is this girl? Why does she come to our house? She told me, you know, this is the girl that belongs to our neighbor. And they have asked me to take care of her because they're busy doing something. He says, as I saw this girl, how sweet she was, how loving she was, how caring she was, I began to actually love her. For the first time in my life, I actually love a girl, a little daughter. I found this compassion in my heart. So when my wife trusted me and she realized that I was loving and caring for this girl, one day she told me, look, I have some news to break to you. Do you love this girl? He says, yes, I really love her. You know, I didn't think that I would love her, but I really love her. I care for her. I feel as if she's my daughter. She told her, I have some news to break to you. Remember 8 years ago, when I was pregnant, you were on that business trip. And when you came back, I told you that the child died. He says, yes, I remember. She told him, I lied to you because you killed 5 of our daughters. And I did not want you to kill this last one. So I lied to you. I had to hide her. I gave her to my neighbor. I trusted her. I told her, you take care of her. And then as the time goes by, I will have her come to my house. And then I realized that today, I am ready to tell you the secret information which I have kept from you. So this is our daughter. Don't you love her so much? Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you didn't kill her. See how beautiful she is, how loving she is. This man tells the Prophet, he says, as soon as I heard that this is my own daughter, I became so angry in my heart. SubhanAllah, I don't understand how some people, God takes the mercy away from their heart. He says, but I didn't show it to my daughter. I acted as if I was happy. And I told her, good job, thank you for saving her. And then as the days went by, I started acting lovingly towards this daughter, so my wife trusts me more. One day, my wife, when she fully trusted me, she left this daughter with me at home. And she told me, I'm going out, please take care of her. He says, okay, I'll take care of her. He says, I found the perfect opportunity. I told my daughter, let's go out and play. He took her out, you know, they lived in a desert, to some place nearby a desert. And he told her, let's play. So she's very excited. She knows this is her father. For the first time, he's taking her out personally to play. He says, I took out the shovel and I started digging in the midst of the desert. Imagine this scene, brothers and sisters. And you'll realize the rahmah of Allah and the religion of Islam, especially when you consider those times. He says, I took out the shovel and I started digging. And as I started digging, the dust, the wind would blow into the dust and the dust would collect on my face. Now my daughter, she would take her hand and she would wipe my forehead. She would wipe my face to clean it from the dust. He says, once I managed to dig this grave, I took my daughter and I pushed her inside. She started screaming and yelling. She said, Father, what kind of game is this? I don't understand. Please explain to me. He says, I didn't care. I started burying her until I buried her alive and I killed her. He said, Ya Rasulallah, those 5 I didn't feel about. You know, they were little. They just probably one day old when I killed them. But for this last one, I feel guilty. I'm so saddened. And I thank God, you know, for the religion of Islam, for guiding me, because I was so ignorant. I thought what I was doing was good. The Prophet, peace be upon him, when he heard this, his beard was soaked with tears. That's how much he cried when he heard the story. Now, brothers and sisters, in that society, in such a society which some of these ignorant Arabs would kill their female daughters, their female infants alive, the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, he came out and he demonstrated to that community how valuable a Muslim woman is. Whenever Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam would come into the presence of the Holy Prophet, he used to stand for her in her honor, and he would kiss her hands and ask her to sit in his seat. And this Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says this religion of Islam, which is so important, it could not have been successful without the efforts of Khadija. Allahu Akbar. Imagine in that society. When my professor heard this, he says, that's amazing. You know, when you then study the life of Muhammad, you see that he was a feminist in those times. For him to give such an amazing treatment to women in a society that considered them to be so insignificant, the Prophet, peace be upon him, is a feminist. And he said, I consider Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, to be a feminist. When we try to explain feminism to others in our Western society, we have to focus on this point. We tell them, look, we have to admit that we have differences. We have biological differences, we have psychological differences. And if you want to be a feminist who defends the rights of women, you have to understand these differences. You have to deal with these differences. And the religion of Islam recognizes these differences. And only when you recognize these differences, then can you protect the rights of women. And then you can explain to them, you know, why is it that we have the hijab? Why is it, for example, that, you know, when we examine the laws between males and females, you know, a lot of times people ask, why is it that the woman gets half the inheritance as man? Isn't this injustice? When you tell them about the differences in our society, the economic differences, and that Islam places the burden of you know, earning a living, of bringing finances to our homes on the man, you understand why he gets more when it comes to inheritance. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never requires a woman to spend on the family, right? Any money you have, it's for you. You spend it on yourself. But as for the person, the father, the husband, it is an obligation on them in the religion of Islam to spend. So they need that extra money, right? If you were to give the same amount of inheritance to women as you would give the men, this is an injustice to men. Because a man, he has to spend on the family. A woman doesn't. So a man needs that extra money, income, inheritance to support his family, to support his wife, to support his children. That's not injustice. So once you examine these differences, it becomes very evident how the religion of Islam actually gives women liberation. When it comes, you know, to the issue of the hijab and women being objectified in society, the religion of Islam gives them liberation, gives them liberty. When it comes to the financial, economic world, Islam gives liberation to women. Islam tells us that it's not a burden on you to go out and bring for your house, to put food on the table. If you would like to do that, that's fine. Allah will reward you. It's out of your own willingness. But this is not an obligation upon you. This is liberation. And once we examine the statistics in our societies, brothers and sisters, and how much so many women are suffering in Western society, and a lot of them don't come out and say that, you know? Because of what has happened in our societies, many women who are suffering, who are being burdened by everyday life, they don't come out and say, we are being burdened. They don't say that, because if they say that, others will consider them weak, they might be taken advantage of, and they don't want that. So they hide their pain. Believe me, I tell you, the average woman in society, the way our society functions, it forces them to hide their pain. The burden that is being placed on them, they have to hide that. They can't say that we're suffering. But when you look at statistics, as I mentioned in the speech, 40% of them are suffering. They're saying we can't cope. They admit it. When people ask them, they admit that we can't cope with what our society has created for us. So the religion of Islam recognizes these differences, and it is by recognizing these differences between males and females that the religion of Islam gives us liberty. Are we done with the session? Respected brothers and sisters, I thank you so much for your time and effort in participating in this event. And I thank you for the questions that you have forwarded. For those questions that we did not have time to get to, please forgive us. Maybe inshallah on a different opportunity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the tawfiq to address them inshallah.
Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
So just to reiterate Sayed's point, I'd like to thank all of you for coming out tonight and posing all those questions. And again, if we do apologize if any of those questions weren't able to be answered today, feel free to pass them to us, and we will do our utmost best to pass them to the Sayed to be answered. I would also like to thank Sayed for spending the time with us to answer all those questions. Please thank him with a loud salawat. We do have a few announcements just to end off the program, so I would ask everyone to please take a seat as we end off the program. I'm going to pass the microphone to our MC tonight, Sister Amreen. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
So before we tell you where the Tabarruk is, could we just please have five times Amma Yujibu for all those who are in need of our du'as. And a Surah Fatiha for all the marhumins of everyone here and all our families. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So thank you once again. Thank you for filling out the surveys. We appreciate all the feedback. If you have any more questions or concerns, don't hesitate to either approach us or contact us at jiy@jaffrey.org. The Tabarruk will be served behind the horizontal partitions. If you have any questions, approach us. And thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Syed, for answering our questions. Salawat.